Those for the shoes. Okay. So this is the a little bit of an overview on the, and I'm gonna try and see if I have a, sorry. I put up, and then maybe Aaron can put it up in the chat window, a little bit about the slides that I've shared. I made them with all Markdown and their HTML. So there are slides that you can follow along and have a record of. But I'm going to talk about the EM algorithm, and that stands for expectation maximization. And I'm going to explain how it works, and especially in the context of what we call mixture models. And so I'll explain what mixture models are. So probably if you learned some elementary distribution and the normal distribution, and those distributions are what we call simple parametric distributions. The distributions I'm going to talk to you about today are what we call the teacher's distribution or the mixtures. And so here you see in this wonderful XKCD cartoon that we have little bumps. And the little bumps are what you get when you have mixtures. And the best way of understanding how mixtures occur is by simulating. But I do want to motivate this with an example. I think it's fair to say that they're really very prevalent in any kind of bioinformatics or biology. And this is an example of CPG island scores that we get when we have occurrences of digrams. We count the number of times C is followed by G, or A is followed by G, or A by T, and so on. And we use that to make scores. And here these scores appear in a histogram. And we see that the scores are different whether you're in an island or not. And so this is what we call a mixture. So it's the same thing which has been measured, but it's been measured in two different populations. Now, of course, in this case, this is what we would say is a generative case, where we actually know that we had two separate populations. And we understand why we got this bimodality. This is multimodal, or bimodality for statisticians means that there are two beats or two modes. And what we're really going to try and understand is, if you see a histogram like that with two bumps, how can you find out what the components are and whether each of the observation is more likely to belong to one bump or the other, and how you can characterize them. So there are two types of mixture models, and I go in detail on the in the book chapter that I'm going to about finite mixture models and infinite mixture models. And today, I don't think I'm going to have time for doing infinite, but I can talk at the end if you ask me questions about it. I'm just going to do finite. And finite just means we only have a few modes, a few components compared to the number of observations. So that's for this. So let's think, first of all, I like to think, I think statistics is backwards and forwards. So the hard part in statistics is reasoning backwards when you have the data and you have to go back to some kind of model that generated those data. But in fact, if you think about how the data are generated, that is the forward model, it makes things simpler. It's an easier way of thinking about things. So to begin with, I'll just think about, suppose that I want to make a mixture with two components, and I'll make the components for the time being be equally likely. That is, the peaks are going to be about the same height, and that's done by flipping a fair coin. And if it comes up heads, I generate a random number, say from a bell-shaped curve with mean one and variance 0.25. And if it comes up tails, I'm going to generate a random number with mean two and variance the same. And I do this like 10,000 times, and because I like to show things in R, this is how I did it. I just took a uniform number And I looked at whether it's bigger than a half, and this gave me my coin flips, and it's not exactly 5,000, but it's not far off. And for each of the coin flips, depending on whether it came head or tails, I generated a mean random number, which is normally distributed with a mean. So one of the means was 1 and the other mean was 3. Okay, so here, and this is what this gives me. So this is the histogram of all the 10,000 values. So this is, of course, they're not all equal to 1, or they're not all equal to 3. Each of these are their own bell-shaped curve. But this is a typical parametric mixture. So we have two components. And in everything I'm going to talk about, I'm going to suppose that we know the number of components in our mixture, and that's often called K. It's the number of clusters in some sense. And here I have two clusters. And you see that they're approximately equally high. And if I, instead of doing this 10,000 times, I did this millions of times, them would like become smoothed out. And as a limit, we get what we call the density. So that density is the limit of the histogram, and it actually has a form. That is that it's 1/2 of the first normal density and 1/2 of the other. And our first normal was the density which has mean 1. And here I have a typo. I already see that this should have been mean 3 for this one. And so this is what it looks like. I did have 3 right here. And so this is the theoretical one, and I get that with the function denorm in R. So this is what I call a density, and it's the density is the limit of the histogram, and it has, let's see, how many parameters involved here? Well, I have a parameter to say how probable the first part is, and 1 minus that parameter for the second part. So the proportion, it would be a parameter, so that's 1. And then I have the mean for the first one and the variance for the first one, the mean for the second one and the variance for the second one. So in all, I have a maximum of 5 parameters. In this case, I'm going to pretend that the variance is known. And so really I'll only have 3 unknown parameters. And so 3 unknown parameters means that it's a small number of parameters compared to the number of observations. And the methods for formulating that are called parametric. So this is a parametric distribution. And this is the density, the theoretical density. So in fact, in that case here, when I did this calculation, it was pretty easy to have two components. That is that these two components that exist are separate. Now, suppose that instead of having a simple separation like that, here, suppose I generated two normals, and let's go back. Here it is, the purple histogram. This is actually not a bell-shaped curve. This was generated as two normals, and but they were actually close enough together that you can't distinguish. So it doesn't really appear as if there were two separate pieces. There's a slight downward in between, but you wouldn't really, this isn't different, the kind of thing that you would get if it was just one histogram with one mode. So I have, I had two coin flips, but in this case, in fact, underlying it, I had the means were closer. And so there wasn't, it was 1 and 2 and it wasn't 1 and 3 and they overlap. So this is very often what happens. It's not so clear that you have a mixture, but then all of a sudden, if you find yourself with a distribution which is broad, and broader than what you would expect, it means underlying that there's a variable, which is your grouping variable, which is not known to you. That hidden variable, in the case of the coin flip, this coin flip that we generated was the latent or hidden variable, and it explains which of the normals was chosen. That's not known. Now, if I show you what actually happened, here I'm going to show you, here are the coin flip. I had the one and the two, and this is actually the distribution. And because they've been stacked in some sense, that is, they're not colored, you take everything into account, what you see with the purple distribution corresponds to this yellow shaded area. And so you get these two distributions together, and they're the mixture. And what you want to do is find out, well, what was the hidden variables? What were the means of these hidden normals? And which of the observations came from which? So this is a less obvious case where you couldn't really guess which one belongs to which. Now there's a huge literature about mixtures. They're very, very useful, and we'll come back to where we often use them. But this was an example of a sort of less obvious mixture and how it was generated. Okay, so now I want to try and give you a feel for how we use the expectation maximization algorithm in order to find out the information about the hidden variables. So what's usually unknown, and in this case, I'm going to suppose for the time being that I know the variance, but I don't know the means of the two groups. I'm going to suppose that they're normal. And I don't know the proportions. You might not know the proportions. And in some sense, the trick in the EM algorithm is to say, okay, I don't know anything. I'll just get going at random. I'm just going to start guessing which observations come from which samples. And then I'm going to say, okay, if these came from these samples, then I can compute the average for the group in one group and the average for the other group, and then I can improve on it. So it's an alternating or iterative procedure. And some of you may have heard of the k-means algorithm for clustering, and it's a little bit similar, but it's not the same. We call the k-means is a, it's a hard threshold method, and the EM is soft, and I'll explain that more. So when you start with the observations yourself, that's what you observe. So in statistics, when we write lowercase, we mean we observe things, and then the uppercase is for the random variable. So in our case, you know, I had, for instance, when I had my 10,000 observations, that would mean that N is 10,000. But you just see the observations and you don't know where they come from. So it was like the case where we just had the yellow or the purple one. You don't know where Y comes from. You don't know the proportion from each group. And you don't know the parameters, the means of each group. So there are a lot of things that you don't know. What we do is we make explicit the fact that we don't know the group. So we augment the data, we add an extra variable, although we don't know it, we're going to add it in. And it makes the problem, by adding a variable, it makes the problem simpler. So we add an unobserved latent variable, which will correspond to, you know, whether the coin was heads or tails, or whether it came from one or the other group. And this is this latent cluster variable, and we're going to call it U for something which is unknown. It's the group. So the augmented data is a series of pairs. And this is the setup for the EM algorithm in many, many different situations. That is, we don't only use the EM algorithm for doing this kind of parametric clustering. We do it in all kinds of situations where you want to do what we call maximum likelihood, that is doing estimation. But we don't know the, we have missing data. So if you have some kind of missing data, EM works well, because we're going to fill in some of the data with values, and then we're going to take those into account and estimate the parameters. But this augmented data set is the one in which I've explicitly put in, so this is the equivalent, you know, the coin toss in some sense. Mm-hmm. Is that okay? Okay.
Susan,
yes, any question? No?
Yeah, I had a question. This is Aaron. Do you start out?
Yeah.
How do you choose the number of distinct groups for you when you start? Is that, are you going to talk?
So in a case like this case, you might not be obvious to you. So you might have to try several cases. So in this case, you know, you might try two or you might try three. Some cases it's obvious, but nothing stops you from using several values and seeing how well you're doing. In general, and I'll show you some of the setups in which we use EM for mixtures. In general, it's pretty clear for the EM how many clusters or how many groups you have. In clustering, we have other methods like the gap statistic or methods like that, but which are a sort of a hardcore criteria for choosing K, the number of clusters. But most of the time, we know what's going to be relevant. And the first thing you usually do is count the number of peaks. That's the basic one. And sometimes that's not sufficient. I'll show you a case where when we do zero inflation, that's not obvious. But nothing stops you from doing various guesses.
Thank you.
And of course, afterwards we can do goodness of fit because this is parametric. So we can look at how well that fits. Okay. Okay, so in the two normals example here, this is the data. These are the observations, the first 15 observations. And they're the ones where we don't know which groups they belong to. Although some of the values, you know, they're towards the right, this value probably you would guess that's in the second group. And the small values, definitely the negative ones, for instance, you say, oh, that's in the left-hand side. So that's in the first group. So we're going to look at the distribution of the two variables. So we have a couples. And this distribution, don't worry too much about the formulas, but you can write it out using Bayes' rule as the distribution, which is the probability of your group given the data, times probability distribution that you have for your y's, for instance. So the data themselves are these values, y's, and the u's are the groups. So those values that I just showed you, like the 2.7537, you can see that it's highly probable that it's in the second group. And this value is highly probable that it's in the first group. And we'll be able to actually make that more precise if we knew what the parameters are. That is, if we know what the mean for both of the groups are. So here, in what I wrote down, I've lumped together the way statisticians do without thinking about it, but I've lumped together in theta the proportion in each group, that's one parameter, and the mean for the first group and the mean for the second group. So I'm saying the variances are known, but this parameter theta is contain a vector of three values. And with that vector of three values, I could write down the probability of all the different observations if I knew them. Okay? So if I know the labels of each of the points, so if I've split that into the red and the blue cloud, I just take all the ones that are red and I take their mean, that gives me an estimate for mu one. And I take all the ones that are blue and I get that in second group. So that would give me the two means, the mu one and the mu two. And I look at the proportion that are blue and the proportion of the red, and that gives me the proportion. So I could estimate those parameters if I knew which observations, which ones of these belong to. Okay, so if the labels we use, and so this method, what we call maximum likelihood, is the method that says I take the density and I compute the value which makes my data the most likely. That's why it's called maximum likelihood. So I and for the mean, it's just the standard way of computing the mean. So and I would like, so I'm just going to, 1 second, because I wrote an extra line and I didn't, and I don't have it. Sorry about that. Excuse me. I have too many things open, of course. That's everybody. That's Wikipedia. There we are. Let's see how far in I am, but it doesn't matter. Okay, so this is it's slightly, I have an extra same variance. There we are. There we have. That's all. Okay. So here, as I said, if we know the labels U, we could use maximum likelihood and compute mu one and mu two. On the other hand, if I know the true means, mu one and mu two, I could assign the groups according to which group is the most likely. So the way I did it on these is I said this large value over here, it's more likely that it's on the right-hand group. And this one I said is, I suppose, so that's one and the other one is three. So that this is what I mean by that. That is, if you know the true means, you can assign the U's according to which one is more likely. And the secret behind the EM is that you pretend each one of these in turn. That is that on the one hand, you're going to pretend that you know the labels, okay? The U's, we're going to pretend that we know them. And then we're going to compute the means. And then we're going to pretend that we know the means, and we're going to assign the labels. So we go, it's a alternating, it's like walking. You know, you lift one foot, you put it up, and you put the other one down, and you just, you know, and that's what it is. That it's an alternating iteration, and we're just going to pretend we know one thing. It's like a flip-flop method. You can write this out in theory, and you know, for what it's worth, we're doing an optimization of what's called the log likelihood. We like to work with the log of the likelihood because that makes it a sum. And when you take a product, the density for all the values, if they're independent, it gives you a sum. And so here we have what's called the marginal likelihood, which is this sum. Don't worry too much about that, but that's just the way the statisticians like to work that, write that down. So you have to get started. And at the beginning of the process, you just, you know, start off at some random value. So in this case, you could say, okay, I could start off and say, well, I don't know anything, so I'm going to put 50-50 in each group, and I'll take the first mean to be completely to the left, and the one, the second one to be slightly to the right, one negative and one positive. And then I can compute the likelihood of the values. So here, these are the values that are in the vector. And so this is just for one of the values. And this is the sum that you get. And that's something that you can compute. And you don't have to worry, you know, this is a function, which is a function of the density, the normal density. And we just write this out in that form. And we're pretending that we know a lot of things. That is, here, I'm pretending that I know the proportion. So here and here. I'm pretending I know the mean of the first distribution and the mean of the second distribution. And I told you we're going to, you know, say that the variance was 0.25, so the standard deviation is 0.5. So that's why we can actually compute it. And then we could say, okay, well, I can compute another value. Suppose that I think that the other mean is 0.9 and this one is minus 0.6. Here, the likelihood is larger, so this is better. If I took minus 2, the likelihood is smaller. So we could maximize this. If I pretend that I know what the, you know, what the values are, I can maximize. So we can do this computation and compute the likelihoods, but we can also do the other thing, which is to compute what the probabilities are that each of the X's belong to one distribution or the other. And so that's done by just computing the densities for the two distributions. So if I have the one which is minus 0.5, I can compute the probabilities that each of these X's belong to that group. And this is the plus 0.5, I can compute the probabilities. So we know how to do that if we know the parameters. Okay, so that's just to say we know how to do it. These are the two steps. So the expectation set is I compute the probability that each point belongs to a given group, and I've stuck in some value. To begin with, it's a completely fake value of the parameters, the way I did just now. I compute those probabilities, and I'm going to then use these probabilities as my weights of the observations, and then compute the estimates of the theta, estimate the distribution parameters. And so the maximization of the likelihood is very simple. If you're computing the mean, it's just taking the weighted sum of the observations, and each observation is going to have a weight equal to it, the probability that it belongs to the group. And so in this case, that will give me the probabilities are being in one group or the other. I just sum all the weights of all the observations for group one and sum all the weights for group two. And the means is just to compute the weighted mean. So that's the two steps. That is, we pretend that the current value, our current guess is known. And then afterwards, we compute a new value for this. And so we just go back and forth. And the miracle is it just converges. It works. So here I wrote out the, don't worry too much about it, but this is the way that you'll see it in the literature. And that's why I wanted to at least write that down, because this is the log likelihood that you do the maximization of, and this is the expectation, the value here where you compute the weights. The probability of each of the observations of being in a group. Now, you can use several initial starting points that to ensure that you always get the same answer to find out whether it's converging right. That's one of the things that you can do. Most of the cases, if you have something which is what we call identifiable, if there's not some confusion as to what one group is compared to the other, then there's no problem. You don't have to redo it several times, but it can be useful to do it. So it's an instructive thing, even in many other situations. That is, it can sometimes be very, you can be blocked on a problem because you have too many unknowns. And it might feel to you as if the unknowns are linked together and that you have to do a high dimensional optimization problem. And really what this corresponds to is what is a little bit like doing a coordinate descent. That is, you're taking one of the pieces of the problem, you're making a progress on one piece, and then you pretend you know that piece, and you take another piece, a different piece of the problem, and you optimize for that piece. And so this is just an alternating strategy, and that comes in when we do what we call Gibbs sampling or many other situations. This is an example of doing soft average. When you're computing the new means, you don't just say, oh, this point belongs to the blue group. It might be that the probability of it being in the blue group is 0.75, and probability of it being in the red group is 0.25. And so you make that point participate in both means, but you give it a weight of 0.25 in one group and 0.75 in the other group. So this is soft averaging. And so you don't have to decide on a hard threshold. Yes, it belongs, it doesn't belong. You just put part of it. And it's the part which is the probability which helps you to do that. So this method of averaging is actually used for other situations. When you do more complex models, sometimes you can't make up your mind about which model is most likely. We don't have to make up your mind. You can do this again, and you can do model averaging, and you can say, okay, I think it's 80% chance that it's this model and 20% that it's this other model. And so we do model averaging for complex methods. So that's useful. And so you can average the models, and then we have the method of k-means, which some of you may have seen for clustering, which is, I'll show you a little animation so that we can see the differences, but it's definitely related to k-means. So in order to illustrate how it works, instead of doing just one dimensional, that is one measurement, like I just showed you with a histogram, here's an animation which uses two. And so this is, it's a GIF, so it's just animating. And it's showing you how it starts off with a two, it actually puts the two points very close together. And then after a few steps, it converges to two separate groups. So it starts off by computing, it takes the initial points a lousy. But after a couple of steps, it's found that it's more probable this group is one group which is separate, and this is another group. And you see it converging as each point participates less and less to the group it's further away from. So that's just an example, and this is the EM. And so instead of having a variance, which is one dimensional, here we have bivariate normal, so we have football-shaped curves. But this is the EM in sort of in action in that case.
Susan?
Yes.
That's a very helpful example. Is it the case that example that there were, that EM was seeded with two classes? Because when you look at the data, it looks like there's two different clusters by I. Or does it more multiple cardinality of classes?
Usually, I have to be honest, in most cases where I use the EM, we kind of know by eye or because of biological reasons how many clusters there are. It's not like in clustering, non-parametric clustering, where you kind of go in and you have no clue. The whole point of it is how many clusters are there. And so the EM algorithm for doing mixture models is most often used when you have the two or three or four components. So a small number of components, and usually we kind of know where they're coming from. But right. So I just have a couple of, I'm not going to go into all the details. I'm going to show a couple of examples, but I did want to give you a link. What I'm talking about is online in the book that I wrote with Wolfgang Huber. So this is Modern Statistics for Modern Biology, and I explain in more details than I have time for today, you know, and here's the coin flips. These are the examples that I just showed you, and there's some more exercises that you can do. But some of the details about the maximum likelihood and the optimization are written down there if you want to see them. And there are different implementations. So we have, seven different packages in R which allow you to do various EM. So you never have to get down to the nitty gritty of how you compute the maximum likelihood or anything like that. They're all available already, but it's very instructive to understand what people mean by the EM algorithm and how it works, just because it enables you to tackle problems. And for instance, I work on the microbiome and the method that we use, which is called DATA2, which we did for filtering. It was inspired in some sense by this EM algorithm. That is, we needed to learn something from the data, and you start off by pretending that you know something that you don't know, and then you update it with more and more iterations. That's all. So that's the examples. And one of the cases where we use it, and I do this much more in detail in the book, and this occurs for my kind of microbiome data and also single cell data, is we have what we call zero inflated data. So in that case, we write out the mixture. We have two pieces. We have a piece in the mixture. In a zero inflated mixture, you have a piece which is sort of what happens. You have all these extra zeros, and then you have data which are not zeros, which are real count data. And so this is an example of what a histogram looks like. And so this is ChIP-seq data, but if you had a nice histogram for this data, now we're not talking about normals. So the example that I did was about normal distributions, but we use the EM algorithm with all kinds of parametric models. And so in this case, what happens is you have a histogram which sort of tells you that I would say that the if I had a distribution here, which was Poisson, say, I would probably expect to have, certainly less than 60,000 zeros. Okay, so I'd have a histogram, it would go up like this, it would be about 60,000. And then I have all of this extra stuff here in my histogram. And so the way of solving that is to say, okay, I have superimposed on top of each other, and this time they aren't even separated. I have a mixture of two things. I have a mixture of distributions which just didn't go through, and I have some of these zeros are real zeros, because when you have a Poisson distribution, you just have a lot of zeros. But they're on top of each other, and that's a zero inflated mixture distribution. And the way you go about finding what the components are, the way inside how it works, is using an EM an EM method. So that's just an example There are quite a few others, but that's the an application where the EM is done, but this time for a Poisson, and we get the proportion of zeros. Here is a mixture, a distribution, and this is actually four peaks, and they're actually the weights of the nucleotides. And the four components, we understand what they are, but we can see that they're not in equal, we don't have equal pieces. That is, here we have the value here that we get, the bottom distribution and the top ones, they're much more frequent than what we have in the middle. And so this is actually corresponds to the C nucleotide, this corresponds to the G, and these were much more prevalent than the others. So you have an unequal share of the four pieces. So this is a histogram. And when you see the data, you can decompose it into these pieces and make the estimation of that. So that's an example where we don't just only have two pieces, we have four pieces. And so let me go back to the, the other thing I wanted to talk about in terms of references was that there's a chapter and a section in particular where Trevor Hasty, Rob Tiprani, and Jerry Friedman talk about the EM algorithm. And I have a link in the slides to what's called the free library where you can go online, but there's also the PDF is free online. So there's a whole section that they do the EM in detail as well. So that's just for references. Now, I did want to show you another example because it's quite compelling. I use it in this situation as well. And this is a situation where you get like, this is the data. So you see this data and these are the points that you see. And if you were doing an ordinary regression situation that you're trying to predict the y's here, this is very uncomfortable because it's obvious that there are actually two relationships going on. And the only way of unraveling these two relationships is to say, okay, with some probability, I'm in a linear regression situation. And the other probability is some kind of quadratic, smooth situation. So you have these two different functions. So there are two things going on. And that's often what happens in the data. When you have some kind of effect which separates it's not just one simple parametric model, it's actually a parametric model which is formed of this mixture. So this is just one of the examples, and the way in which this is fit is actually by postulating a mixture model, fitting the parameters to the mixture model. And the only problem that you end up with is you can assign, the points to the group that it's most likely to belong to, and you can use the parameters. But the overlap here gives you an example of what we call non-identifiability. And so what happens in the overlap region is you can't really decide where so that's a difficulty. And so here, this is the output. This is just an R program. You can try it out. It's called FlexMix. So it's flexible mixture modeling. And it allows you to do, in particular, if you've seen GLMs, it allows you to do mixtures of GLMs. And so you have generalized linear models, but you have two different populations doing two different things. So that's how it works. And so in that case, in the parameter estimation afterwards, so here the output says the linear model is factor one, those are all red. The quadratic is blue, it's factor two. So they've been split and they've been assigned to the groups that they're the most likely, the highest probability of being in. And you just have to be careful in the overlap, there's nothing sure. That is, they're equally likely to be in either group and they've been sort of assigned at random here. So there's this non-identifiability, but that's an example of using the EM algorithm. That's how it worked. That is the fit this curve on the data at the same time as this curve. And so this was two pieces. So it seemed pretty obvious from the data, K equals two, so there's no problem there. And then we put in GLM parameters. So you have a parametric model, one was a linear one, one was a quadratic. So that's just an example. And I just talked to you a little bit about the zero inflated and the data here when you have this situation. There's another situation which we use mixtures a lot for, and that is deciding whether something is overexpressed or overabundant. And so we have some proportion, and that started off, for instance, in microarrays and RNA-seq, we have some proportion P0 of the genes which are not expressed. They're in their standard unexpressed form. And then you have a small proportion which are expressed, and you want to find out what proportion are overpresent, overabundant, or overexpressed. And so there's an example for proteomics, for instance, here. And in general, what you see or what you hope to see in those cases is that you have something which is bimodal. That is, you have a kink on the right. And I hope to see, I had an example here where you had bimodality of the expression. That is, some of them are underexpressed. And so the bimodal, the visualization in some sense, you can do that in proteomics as well as you can do it in any kind of RNA-seq or anything like that. So again, this is the presence of mixtures, and depending on the type of data that you have, we fit those two mixtures. And this can be really important because the P0 and the one minus P0, it tells you what proportion are you expecting to be significant. And so when you're doing the false discovery rate estimation, this fitting is really important. Okay, so the I showed you the case of more than two components. The limit that you can do and still is just to have as many in your mixture as you have observations, then it becomes non-parametric. And the bootstrap is an example of that, a mixture in which every point puts a weight on its value. So here, there were 15 values and 1 over 15 is the weight of every point. That's a mixture and that's what's used for doing the bootstrap. So when you're doing resampling, we use this particular mixture. And we call it non-parametric because there are as many parameters as there are data points. So a non-parametric method is just a method which has too many parameters. And you have to put in an extra smoothing constant. But so I explain that in the book. So that's also part of the book and I won't go in, but that's sort of what brings you back to doing non-parametric methods from mixtures. Okay, so I just want to finish off with the buzzwords that I think, if you just want to finish and say, what did I learn or whether I learned something from the words that I used. One word which was really useful was the density. So the density was the limit of the histogram as we increase the number of observations. And then I have another name for the density. If I take the density as a function of the parameter, I call that the likelihood. That's the probability of seeing the data for a value of the parameter. And if it's a function of the parameter, then that's the likelihood. I kept on talking about mixtures, and mixtures are when they have several different underlying processes that generate the data. So for instance, you might look at the, you know, heights of a population of students, and you'll see that in general, you see two peaks, and that many of the boys are taller than the girls. And so that's a sort of a bimodal distribution. And that is, there's an underlying difference in the population. So that we use those mixtures as a good model. The explanation, so boy-girl separation, for instance, that is the latent variable. And so I showed you the nucleotides. We had four peaks, and they were ACGT were the explanation, and the latent variable is the nucleotide. So the latent variable tells you the underlying hidden variable. This is the peaks. I talked about soft clustering versus hard clustering, and that's just the idea that instead of saying, no, yes, this point belongs to a cluster or it doesn't belong to a cluster, when I compute the averages, I just put in the weight of how likely it is that it belongs to the cluster. That will give me the weight of that point in computing the mean of the clustering. So that's a soft clustering versus hard clustering, and hard clustering, for instance, the k-means is a well. And then I said it's a good example of what's called an alternating algorithm. And there are others. So for instance, when you do MCMC, we have something called Gibbs sampling, where you pretend that you know all the other coordinates except one. And then you look at the conditional distribution given all the other coordinates except one, and you simulate according to that one. And then you do another step where you're pretending that you know all the others except a different coordinate. And so you go on like that, and that's also alternating. But I think it's an interesting paradigm, the alternating paradigm. Okay, so any more questions? I don't see anything in the chat. Does anybody have any questions?
Susan, I have one to get things started. About a third of the way into the talk, you presented this scenario where there was a mixture of two different means, and you had that yellow distribution.
Yeah.
What you observe. And I think that's a very common scenario for a lot of the work that you do. You have this distribution that looks roughly normal.
But yeah.
In that case, you knew ahead of time that it's not, that it was generated from two distributions. Can you just comment a little bit about, I mean, in this case, you might just move on and say that's normal. Is it the case that you want to apply sort of a goodness of fit test to make sure that it's not actually normal?
Yeah.
Then explore EM?
So most people look at this and they say it's normal. Statisticians will say it's too fat. But the only way really of knowing that is to make a QQ plot. And so a QQ plot is, and I don't have one off the bat, but it's a plot in which you take the data and you can see that the data aren't normal. And so in that case, so for instance, if I generated data, let's see Brave and see if I can find my, wait a minute. Let's see. All right, let's see whether I can do this in real time. It's usually not a good idea, but let me generate a whole bunch of data. I guess This might, I don't know. Well, I don't really need ggplot, but it doesn't matter. I just want to take the data. So here, this was an easy case. And I'm going to take the case that you were just challenging me about, which is the less separate one. And so then I'm going to do this. Here we are. There's a... And this one. This like, and then this one. And this one comes out. And then, oh, no, that's fine. Oh, but it's still separate. It's nice and separate again. I was trying to find one where you couldn't see, but if I do a QQ plot, so if I do a QQ plot, just to show you what the, so, output. QQ more. So here, this is a very squiggly line. And this is what occurs when you have data which are not normal, but that might look normal. So they might look as if they come from a nice normal distribution, but they're a mixture. And if that mixture, for instance, you have, so in the previous one, if I go back and, so mean to, so here I write 1.5. That would be something like that. Output. So I do this. Here we are. So it's still the case that we have this squiggle that occurs, and you can see that it's not normal distributed. Now, what I want to find, if I do the histogram, I want to see whether I can see it so clearly. They're separated. Sorry, that's not what I wanted. I wanted to find a case, but I promise you, if you look at a QQ plot on the data, you can tell much, much better than looking at a histogram, because in the histogram, the data just go up and they come down, and in a QQ plot, they don't. So that's how statisticians know. If it's slightly S-shaped, they know that the data are not normal. So that's the first suspicion that the data are slightly off normal. Now, of course, I showed you an example which is one-dimensional, and very often we have data which are two or three-dimensional where the blobs are much clearer. That is, things get separated out more clearly. But it's definitely the case that if you do a QQ plot, you'll find that you see things which are not so, which although they go up and down, you have, and you can compute, for instance, the how fat it is, the distribution, we compute the second and the third and fourth cumulants, and they tell you how far away it is from the normal. So there are lots of ways in which statisticians are normal. I would say that for biological data, it's quite rare that the data are normal, and much more often mixtures of normals, just because you have added sources of variability like batch effects. So the other thing that we often see is batch effects, which create this separation where you actually have an extra source of variability, which makes the distribution larger than what you expect. But it's definitely a good question, but always suspicious of a normal and always do Q.